Now we're recording.
More within myself. I think about that should be doing something about it. I should be talking to someone. I just don't know anyone who I think is good enough to follow this. I don't know a traditional therapist. They've done that. So I've kind of been a quandary about it.
We need to find somebody to bring that.
Emma Thomas.
I have criteria. But I guess I'm not. Because I'm afraid to do anything that's too extreme, too dramatic about things.
Thomas Walmart for stuff in the resilience.
Oh, you did? But then again, I guess.
It
can slip by me.
You just borrow
on the other hand. So they're polarized.
That's how I discovered that extra little quote.
That's in the Greek. It's in the Oxford Blue. It's in the Thomas Taylor.
It's by the Blue.
The section is on the low about God. Right after you get past the mirror, what's there for? They don't look to the divine.
Oh, that wasn't.
It's an eighth step the Lord doesn't make. Bill was pointing out last week. Not in the
law. Yeah, we went through it. The way I did the Stephanon is I just counted quotes, And suddenly had three
extra. Wait a minute.
What's going on here? Yeah, a couple extra side comments going on.
So then, we left it at page 83, is that the name of the guy?
112 BC, or
what was it? 112?
I don't know, I got
83, page 83 is 127.
Yeah. 127?
E.
Yeah.
Or D, that's all you're in.
Yeah, D, E, we got right to
that extra part we were talking about here is at 133C. It's a lot of interchange.
There's some discussion in the textual notes on it. Taylor put it in the Oxford Blue text. It's in the Oxford Classical text. And there's some guy Eusebius or something or somebody like that it's attributed to. But I thought they concluded in some sense that it was, sound. Although I didn't hear the argument. But
this
counts as
standard.
We'll take it.
Good. Bottom 101.
All right.
This one and then this
next section is
yeah, good. So this is four energy.
Okay.
I do.
The
Some of this tonight is a nice section. So that we've got some readers and proceed.
Are you ready to play? Would you like to play?
No.
I'll play.
Good, which one?
Okay, Sock.
You'll take Sock, we need an Alcibiades.
Oh, Alcibiades.
Alcibiades.
Where are we at?
127 DB.
Numbers, I understand, on page 83, right?
Or 189 in the lobe.
That's right.
Is that the only translation of this here?
Yeah, he's on zero, yeah. What are we reading, the lobe or the...
Practically bouncing, sorry. Those copies were furnished by Carolyn Bill, so...
Is that the right word? Lent?
Does anyone have a date yet?
Hi, everybody, it's great seeing you.
Okay, remember the Alamo.
Okay.
Who's Socrates? Who's doing Sock?
I was.
You're doing the Logi?
Oh, you're doing... Oh. What page is it?
83.
83?
Where are we going to start, where he's confused?
Yeah.
But you must take courage.
Wait a minute, let me say this.
Let's do this, Alcibiades.
Now, by the God, Socrates, I myself do not know what I mean, but it looks as if I have, for some time, been unconsciously in a most disgraceful state.
You must take courage. If you had discovered this lamentable condition of yours when you were 50, it would have been difficult for you to take care of yourself. But now, you are just at the age when the discovery should be made.
What then ought the discoverer to do, Socrates?
Answer questions, Alcibiades. And if you do this, God willing, and if any trust can be put in my own prophetic power, we shall both be the better for it.
So far as it depends on my answering, that statement shall be made good.
Come then, what is it to take care of yourself in order that we may not be mistaken, as we often are, in supposing that we are taking care of ourselves and we are not doing so? Is it when a man is taking care of that which is his, that he takes care of himself?
I should be inclined to think so.
What? When does a man take care of his feet? Is it not when he is taking care of things which belong to his feet?
I don't understand.
Do you speak of anything as belonging to the hand? For instance, would you say that a ring belongs to any part of a man except a finger?
Certainly not.
And a shoe to the foot, in like manner?
Mm-hmm.
And cloaks and the other garments of the body likewise?
Yes.
Then when we are taking care of our shoes, we are taking care of our feet.
I don't quite understand, Socrates.
You do not, Alcibiades? Well, do you give any name to the proper taking care of anything whatsoever?
I do.
Do you not say that a man takes proper care when he makes a thing better?
Sure.
What art, then, makes shoes better?
The shoemakers.
Then by the shoemaker's art, we take care of our shoes.
Yes.
And is it by the shoemaker's art that we take care of our feet, or by that art by which we make our feet better?
By the latter.
And the art by which we improve our feet is that by which we improve the rest of the body?
So it seems to me.
And is not this gymnastic?
Most assuredly.
Then by the gymnastic art, we take care of the foot. But by the shoemaker's art, of that which belongs to the foot.
Certainly.
And by the gymnastic art, we take care of our hands. But by the art of engraving rings, of that which belongs to the hand.
Yes.
and by gymnastics we take care of the body. But by the art of weaving and the other arts of that which... But by the art of weaving and the other arts... And the other arts of that which belongs to the body.
I agree with you entirely.
Then there is one art by which each one of us takes care of himself, and a different one by which he takes care of that which is his.
It appears so.
Then when you are taking care of that which is yours, you are not taking care of yourself.
Certainly not.
For it is not, it seems, the same art by which a man takes care of himself and that which is his.
It does not appear so.
Come then, by what kind of art might we be able to take care of ourselves?
I'm unable to say.
But at any rate, this much is agreed, that it is not the art by which we make better anything, whatever, of that which is ours, but by which we make ourselves better.
True.
Could we ever have known, then, what art makes a shoe better, if we did not know what a shoe is?
Oh, it's impossible.
Now, what art makes rings better, if we did not know a ring?
True.
Nor what art makes rings better, if we did not know a ring.
True.
Well, then, can we ever know what art makes the self better, if we do not know what we ourselves are?
Impossible.
Does it happen, then, to be an easy thing to know oneself? And was it some trifler who inscribed those words on the temple at Pithos? Or is self-knowledge a difficult thing and not for all?
To me, Socrates, it has often seemed a thing that anyone might attain, and often, too, very difficult.
But whether it is easy or not, Alcibiades, the state of the case so far as we are concerned is this. If we knew ourselves, we might know how to take care of ourselves, but never otherwise.
True.
Come then. In what manner might the self of selves be discovered? For thus we could perhaps discover what we ourselves are, but so long as we are ignorant of it, that would be impossible.
You speak truly.
Listen in, for the love of Zeus. With whom are you now conversing? Is it not with me?
It is.
And am I not conversing with you?
You are.
It is Socrates, then, who is discoursing.
Most certainly.
And Alcibiades, who is listening.
It is.
And is not Socrates discoursing by means of speech?
How else?
And would you not call discoursing and using speech the same?
Certainly.
But the user and the thing used are different.
What do you mean?
As a shoemaker, for instance, cuts with a knife and a chisel and with other tools.
Yes.
And so the cutter and user of the tools is not the same as the tools with which he cuts.
How could he be?
Well, likewise, therefore, the instruments which a harp player uses might be distinguished from the player himself.
Yes.
This, then, was the question which I asked you just now. Does the user always seem to be different from that which he uses?
He does.
What, therefore, shall we say of the shoemaker? Does he cut with his tools only or with his hands also?
With his hands, too.
Then he uses these also?
Yes, he does.
And does he also use his eyes in cutting leather?
He does.
We agree that the user is different from that which he uses.
Yes.
And the shoemaker and the harp player are different from the hands and eyes by which they work.
It seems so.
And does not a man use his whole body?
Certainly.
And that which uses is different from that which it uses?
Yes.
And that which uses is different from that which it uses?
Yes.
Then the man and his body are different things.
It seems likely.
What, therefore, is the man?
I am unable to say.
Not at all, for you can say he is that which uses his body.
True.
Does anything but the soul use the body?
Nothing.
And does she not rule it?
She does.
Further, I think no one will differ from me in this.
In what?
the statement that the man is one of three things.
What things?
Soul, body, or both of these compounded into one whole.
What then?
But we agreed that that which rules the body is the man.
We did.
Does the body then rule itself?
By no means.
For we said that it would rule.
Yes.
The body then cannot be that which we are seeking.
It would not seem so.
But does the compound of the two rule the body? And is this the man?
Very likely.
Least likely of all. For if one of the principles is subject, there is no means whatsoever whereby they may both rule jointly.
True.
But since the man is neither the body nor the combination of the two, it remains, I think, either that the self is nothing at all, or if it be anything, it must be concluded that the man is no other than soul.
Very much so indeed.
Must it then be proved to you still more clearly that the soul is man?
No, by Zeus, it seems to me to have been proved sufficiently.
If reasonably well, though not accurately proved, it is enough for us. For we shall know more accurately when we discover that which we just now passed by, for fear that its investigation might be too much for us.
What was that?
That which was said just now in some such manner as this, that first of all, the self of selves would have to be investigated. But now instead of that, we have investigated the nature of the individual self. And perhaps that will be enough, for we could not say that anything was more truly ourselves than the soul.
Certainly not.
Then we may not fairly conclude that you and I are conversing with one another by means of words, soul to soul.
When we read that?
Okay. Then may we not fairly conclude that you and I are conversing with one another by means of words, soul to soul?
We may.
Then it was this that we meant when we said a little while ago that Socrates is discoursing with Alcibiades by means of speech, addressing his discourse not, it seems, to your outward person, but to the real Alcibiades, and that is the soul.
It seems so to me.
And he who enjoys knowing, know thyself, bids us become acquainted with the soul.
Apparently so.
Then he who has some knowledge of this bodily nature has gained a knowledge of that which is his, but not of himself.
Just so.
Of the physicians, then, not one knows himself in so far as he is a physician, nor of the trainers in so far as he is a trainer.
Apparently not.
Then the husbandmen and the other craftsmen are very far from knowing themselves, for they, it seems, do not even know that which is theirs, but things still further removed from it, according to the trades which they follow. For they only know that which is the body's, and by which it is served.
True.
If then wisdom is the knowledge of oneself, none of these is wise only to his craft.
I think not.
And for this reason, such crafts seem to be better, and not such as a good man would own.
Very true.
Then, as we have been saying, he who takes care of his body takes care of that which is his, but not of himself.
It seems likely.
But he who takes care of his money takes care neither of himself nor what is his, but of things still further removed from what is his.
It seems so to me.
And the businessman is not minding his own business.
You're right.
And so, if anyone has fallen in love with the body of Alcibiades, it was not Alcibiades that he loved, but one of Alcibiades' possessions.
True.
But he who loves you, loves your soul.
It seems to follow from the discussion.
The lover of your body goes away when its bleeding fades.
So it seems.
But the lover of the soul will not go away while that soul goes on to greater perfection?
Probably he will not.
And so I am the lover who goes not away. It remains at your side when your beauty is fading and the others have gone.
In that you do well, Socrates. Never go away.
Then try to be at your best.
I will make every effort.
for the state of your case is this Alcibiades, the son of Clinias. It seems neither had nor, it seems, neither had, Alcibiades, the son of Clinias, it seems, neither had nor had any lover except only one. And this beloved one is Socrates, the son of Sophroniscus and Phaenicia.
True. You know you don't know how to pronounce your mother and father's names.
Oh, yeah.
What is that? Sophroniscus?
Yeah,
is that
so this girl back here is just pointing out. Sophron
in the
Is that Sophron?
It would be related to Sophrosune.
Yeah, that's what Orestes is.
Aristeus.
Yeah. It's got Aristeus. What's the
Sophrosune built right in? Yeah, I'm thinking of a pier. Phino is a pier.
Phino.
What?
The appearance of art, Sarah was saying?
I'm trying to figure out what the fine is before the art.
And did you not say that if I had not...
Wait a minute, is that do you think that's a play on words, or do you think that's true?
Maybe his name.
His
I
name
know.
Mentioned.
Family name?
He's mentioned him elsewhere as his name.
Pardon?
He mentioned Fanarete
in...
Yes.
He mentions his father in the Hippias, Greater Hippias. Right? This guy that lives with me. We'll never tolerate that kind of an answer. What's his name?
What was it?
The son of Sophrosunis.
But the form, the word form, may pull in the word play. That's what they always say. What the form of the word is.
Yeah.
How it's
fine.
What?
The
way
the
ship was
built. God.
What?
She's
whispering.
She was saying.
Just in the fine from where it's fine art is, I don't know, but there's a verb fino, which is in the first entry is to bring to light, make to appear, make known, reveal, disclose. Just play with the name.
So what are those two words that you're talking about?
Well, there's somebody's name, but the first one, the sophron, comes from temperance. So the sune is temperance.
Or else somebody's answer is
wishy-washy.
The second
one, phrenarte, is arte, is like virtue or excellence.
It's
fine. I keep just playing with the verb that makes the bring to light or make to appear.
He's got the seams in there. He's got kind of true. I see what you're saying. Orthos, that's right.
Ooste.
I've looked up several Greek names lately, and they're all really nice.
Yeah, very true. And it's most of the same.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's
all safe answers.
Some of them are.
Some are really direct. I mean, there might be a significance of it.
That says right. True, yeah.
How are you going to do that? That's in Greek.
Or is it right? We don't hear how he says it. Remember that?
Since it's clear and quite true, why not? It's only true. So it seems to call for discussion. Probably does.
Maybe there is. Something with the grammar. See a little mood on that floor or something like that.
Yeah.
I don't know. Mm-hmm. The stem is playing.
Okay.
All right.
And did you not say that if I had not spoken to you first, you were on that point of coming up to me to inquire why I alone had not deserted you?
Yes, for it was so.
This, then, was the reason, that I alone loved you, but the others, that which is yours. That which is yours is losing its freshness, but you are beginning to bloom, and now you are not spoiled by the Athenian people and made less fair. I never will desert you. No. And now, if you are not spoiled by the Athenian people and made less fair, I never will desert you. For this is what I fear most, that you should become a lover of the people and be lost to us, since many a noble Athenian has been ruined so. Fair faces, the people of a great-hearted Erechtheus. But you should see it naked. Be cautious, therefore, as I bid you.
Boy, I'm really suspicious of that last sentence. How cautious?
Train yourself, my dear sir, and engage in politics when you have learnt what is necessary, not before, so that you may be prepared with an antidote and come to no harm.
That's good advice, Socrates, but try to explain the manner in which we should take care of ourselves.
Then we have made this much of an advance. Then we have made this much of an advance. What we are has been reasonably well agreed upon. Before that point was settled, we were afraid that we might be unconsciously taking care not of ourselves, but of something else.
Quite true.
And next, we agreed that we must take care of the soul and look to that.
Clearly.
But that the care of bodies and wealth should be consigned to others.
Why not?
In what way, therefore, can we know the soul most clearly? For knowing this, it seems, we shall know ourselves also. Can it be that we do not understand the excellent meaning of the Delphic inscription we mentioned just now?
What have you in your thoughts, Socrates?
I will tell you what I suspect to be the meaning and counsel which this inscription has for us. For I venture to think that an illustration of it is to be found not everywhere, but only in the sight.
Well, what do you mean?
Consider. If anyone were to say to the eye, as though he were giving counsel to a man, see thyself, what should we suppose him to recommend by this? Would it not be that the eye should look at that by looking at which it would see itself?
Clearly.
Let us consider then what that object is, in looking at which we see ourselves, and it at the same time.
Clearly, Socrates, in looking in mirrors and the like.
You are right. And is there not something of this kind in the eye by which we see?
Certainly.
Then have you noticed that the face of anyone who looks in the eye of another is visible, as in a mirror, in the eyes of the person opposite him? And so we call this the pupil, because it is an image of the beholder.
Quite true.
And so an eye, beholding an eye, and looking at its most perfect part, and that by which it sees, would thus see itself? Let me read that again. And so an eye beholding an eye, looking at its most perfect part, and that by which it sees, would thus see itself?
Apparently.
But if it looks at any other part of the man, or at any other object except that which itself resembles, it would not see itself.
True.
Then if the eye is to see itself, it must look at an eye, and at that part of the eye in which the virtue of the eye resides. And this is, I suppose, sight?
Just so.
And so, my dear Alcibiades, the soul too, if she is to know herself, must look at soul, and especially at that region of the soul in which wisdom, the virtue of the soul, resides, and whatever else is like this.
I agree, Socrates.
And can we say that any region of the soul is more divine than that which is the seat of knowledge and understanding?
We cannot.
This region of the soul, then, is most like God. And one who looked at this and came to know all that is divine, God and all wisdom, would thus gain most knowledge of himself.
It seems so.
Shall we not say, then, that just as mirrors are clearer, purer, and brighter than the mirror in the eye, so God is purer and brighter than the best that is in our soul.
It seems likely, Socrates.
Looking at God, therefore, we should use his most beautiful mirror, and among human affairs we should look at the virtue of the soul, and thus we may best see and know ourselves.
Yes.
And we agree that to know oneself is wisdom.
Certainly.
And now this whole section you're saying, Tom.
Yeah. Well, it's the one that I do. Do you follow it?
I have no idea.
You've got lost of it,
right?
Yeah, but you've got lost bits.
133C.
Is part of her resemble Scott from there, or the part that follows isn't even wrong?
The part...
Shall we not say, then, that the mirrors are clear? That part's not...
Read the whole passage.
That's not in the law?
Shall we not say, then, that this, just as mirrors are clearer, pure, and brighter than the mirror in the eyes, so God is pure and bright and the best that is in our soul? That, starting there, that spirit leads out in the world. Right.
2 exchanges, Barbara.
Could you read
from the sock?
What's the tail end of the last entry that you would have?
The one that you, the last one you would have would be like Socrates saying, "This region of the soul then is most like to God."
After the apparent,
and like she didn't read this line. Yeah,
jump here.
I see. Thanks.
And then, see, then it jumps, and they agree to know that no one's self is wisdom is where the love comes in.
Where'd you find that about that? The love text is the Greek text.
Yeah, they just put it in the Bible in Oxford.
What page are you? And the Lord?
213.
That's one. Omitted.
Yeah, Rod says it's in the other Greek text.
Well, it's certainly one of the weakest sections in what I'm done.
And a pivotal.
Isn't that tragic?
Yeah.
I mean, if you had to cut out a hunk, that's like cutting out the allegory. Okay?
It's the whole method. The whole connection.
Or an analogy.
Yeah, it's an analogy.
What's the analogy spell out?
When you're looking in other eyes to see the eye sees itself in other eyes, and God's saying, then just as mirrors are clearer and purer and brighter than the mirror in the eye, see the eye. So God is pure and brighter than the best that is in his soul. And looking at God, therefore, we should use his most beautiful mirror.
That's in the soul.
That's how we see the soul, the virtue of the soul.
So, the mirror is our God, and the mirror in the eye is the best in the soul.
No, not the mirror in the eye, but the face in the mirror is purer and brighter than the eye in the eye.
Like just as mirrors are clear and pure and brighter than mirrors in the eye,
right.
So God is pure and brighter than the best in the soul. Mirrors are the God, as mirrors in the eye are the best in the soul.
Oh.
Which is the seed of knowledge and understanding. That's the most, that's the best part of the slide.
Right.
If you go back up.
Yeah.
Here, that's where you see what that we're looking for.
Sophia.
Yeah.
There's some comment on it. It must have came together with the rest of the text separately. You know what I mean? They were like in isolation. One manuscript was found without that, and other manuscripts were found with it. It's generally attributed to some guy, Eusebius or something like that. It's in the Oxford Blue
Classic.
You mean
that he added it?
It's in the Oxford opera.
It's Taylor has it in his translation.
The Mirror of Analogy?
Yeah, it's in Thomas. Tommy got it. Olympiodorus, the only fragments of Proclus in the Neoplatonists on this dialogue, they cut off before you get to this section, because the Proclus commentary was lost. So he deals with all the earlier arguments we went through, but when you get up to this section, the whole tail end of the dialogue is lost. And the only fragment that remains of it comes from Olympiodorus, and it had to do with some concern that they were playing with between the same in itself and each in itself. That section went back to earlier, but he didn't say what the issue was that I can recall. He said something about it, and I don't, you know. So maybe I'll call Xerox it. Anybody that's sure it's a half a page, you know. Yeah.
Sure. We have to get a Xerox machine. Huh?
Yeah.
Do it right here. Yeah.
Be nice.
There's a thing.
I know. Yeah, that's
it.
So look here.
Sarah's just seeing here that footnote in the Loeb is a variant reading even in the Loeb section because the clear and brighter is split, it looks like. He's pulling them both together. Maybe he's giving you the man and the god, or the soul and the god, because he splits it right there. You know the section, this section, in your text it reads, shall we not say then, just as mirrors are clearer, purer, and brighter than the mirror in the eye, so God is pure and brighter. From Olympiodorus here you get so God, and from Nasus it would go in there. Right. And the next thing he picks up coming out of this crescendo is phronesis again. So self-knowing is phronesis. Right. Coming down the other side. Oh, it's different? Oh, it's sophrosynes. Oh, God. Interesting stuff. Well, then, I don't know what he's doing. I could still be doing that, couldn't I?
I wonder what it is. It's an important
section.
Maybe another text with another paragraph.
Yeah. Oh, God, best in the soul. That's why I see those.
Is that we finish and then go back?
Yeah.
Yes.
That was a good quote.
Where are we now?
Pick a yes and read after. 102.
Rick?
Second section.
Yes.
And we agreed that to know oneself is wisdom.
Certainly.
And so if we do not know ourselves, and are not wise, is it possible for us to know our own good and evil?
How could it be possible, Socrates?
For perhaps it appears impossible to you, not knowing Alcibiades, to know that which is his and that it is his. Perhaps it appears impossible to you, not knowing Alcibiades, to know that which is his and that it is his.
It does certainly, by Zeus.
Nor can we know that which is ours and that it is ours unless we know ourselves.
How could we?
And if we cannot know that which is ours, nor can we know that which belongs to that which is ours.
It seems that we cannot.
Then if we are not altogether right in agreeing just now that there are some who do not know themselves, but that which is theirs, but others who know that which belongs to that which is theirs. For the perception of all these things seems to be the province of one individual and of one art, himself, that which is his, and that which belongs to that which is his.
It seems likely.
Oh, I see.
Three levels, the same mark.
Yeah.
Three levels. One up.
Clever, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Likewise be ignorant of that which belongs to others?
Certainly.
And if he is ignorant of that which belongs to others, he will be ignorant of the affairs of cities.
Here we go. Inevitably.
Then such a man would not be a politician?
Certainly not.
Nor the manager of a household?
Certainly not.
He will not know what he's doing?
He will not.
And will not, if he does not know what he is doing, make mistakes?
Assuredly.
And if he makes great mistakes, will he not fare badly both in his private and public capacity?
Indeed he will.
And very badly will he not be miserable?
Extremely miserable.
And that of those with whom he is dealing? And what of those with whom he is dealing?
They will be miserable too.
Then it is impossible for anyone to be happy if he be not wise and good.
It is impossible.
The bad then are miserable?
Most miserable.
And so not he who has wealth, but he who has wisdom is delivered from misery.
It appears so.
Cities then, Alcibiades, if they are to be happy, do not need walls or tyrants or docks or numbers or size without virtue.
Indeed they do not.
And if you are to manage the affairs of the city rightly and well, you must impart virtue to the citizens?
Unquestionably.
But can a man impart that which he has not?
How could he?
You yourself, then, should first acquire virtue, and so should any other who means to govern and manage not only himself and his own private affairs, but the state and the affairs of the state.
True.
You must not, therefore, procure for yourself or the state authority and power to do what you wish, but justice and wisdom.
So it seems.
For both you and the city, if you act justly and wisely, will act in accordance with the will of God.
That may be supposed.
And as we said just before, you will act thus by looking at that which is divine and splendid.
So it appears.
And moreover, by looking thither, you will perceive and know yourself and your own good.
Yes.
And therefore you will act rightly and well.
Yes.
And moreover, if you act thus, I will pledge myself that you will be happy.
Your pledge is a safe one.
But if you act unjustly and look at that which is godless and dark, you will, as is probable, do deeds of a like nature, being ignorant of your true selves.
This is difficult. Why did you say selves?
Why?
phone number.
Oh.
It's okay with me if you don't.
What's your rule?
Must be someone who really knows her on that one. I won't hazard any guesses at this point.
First, the initial probably V, though, huh?
Answered yet, because I'm still worried about this, your true selves. This is cool. Very likely.
For if my dear Alcibiades, a man has power to do as he likes, but lacks mind, what is likely to be the result, either to him as an individual or to the state? For instance, when a sick man has the power to do as he wishes and has not the mind of a physician, but is moreover in the position of a tyrant, so that no one dares to recruit him, what will happen? Will it not be most probably the destruction of his body?
True.
Or again, in the case of a ship, if a man had power to do what he thought proper, but had no intelligence or skill in navigation, do you see what would happen to him and his fellow sailors?
I do. They would all be lost.
Is it otherwise then in the state or in any office of offices of command and authority? When they lack virtue, does it not follow that they fare badly?
Definitely.
Then it is not absolute power, my dear Alcibiades, that you must procure for yourself or for the state if you are to be happy, but virtue.
True.
And before virtue is acquired, to be governed by his superior is better than to govern, not only for a child, but for a man.
Evidently.
And that which is better is also more beautiful.
Yes.
And that which is more beautiful is more fitting.
Certainly.
Then it is fitting for the bad man to be a slave because better.
Yes.
Then wickedness is for slaves.
It seems so.
But virtue for the free.
Yes.
And my friend, is not that which is fit for slaves be avoided?
Most certainly, Socrates.
Do you perceive now how it is with you, as befits a free man or not?
I think I perceive very clearly indeed.
And do you know how to escape from your present condition, not to mention it before a gentleman?
I do.
How?
If you wish it, Socrates.
That is not well said, Alcibiades.
What ought I say then?
If God wills.
I say it then. And further I say that our characters seem likely to be reversed, for from this day forward I shall not fail to follow you as you have followed me.
My noble sir, my love will be like the stork, for having hatched out a winged love in you, it will be cherished by it in turn.
But it is so, and henceforth I shall begin to cultivate justice.
And I hope that you will succeed, but I have fears, not because I distrust your character, but I see the strength of the state, which may be too much for the both of us.
Socrates playing the Delphic Oracle, philosophical Delphic Oracle.
What was your question?
So
Socrates playing the philosophical Delphic oracle. Where we started.
127D.
All right, do you agree what he's looking at? It would be just the way we started this evening. This is a state of mind. Judging the state of mind, isn't it? And that's the old question in the Republic that he played with. That he seems to have an idea of certain stages that people go through, and they should be in it for certain periods of time and certain ages. It takes a certain time for ideas to hatch, and you better be in the right time frame and spend as much time as appropriate. We've done that. So going back to the beginning, are able to. Do you agree? Starts with a state of mind. Now, by the God Socrates, I myself do not know what I mean. But it looks as if I, after some time, been consciously in a most disgraceful state. Right? That's a state of mind. That is, he just came to recognize, didn't he? But it looks as if I have for some time been unconsciously in a most disgraceful state of mind. So he's just come to realize something. I myself do not know what I mean. I myself do not know what I mean. I've been in that state for a while. I didn't know that. It's disgraceful. If you had discovered this lamentable condition of yours when you were 50, it would have been difficult for you to take care of yourself. But now you're at the age when the discovery should be made. That's appropriate. It's appropriate. Right age for being in that. That's all right. It's proper age. Well, then what I want to discover, Sock, when you're in that state of mind, you say, you know what you ought to do? Answer questions. Right? This is the state. This is the state. And that state of mind needs something. In that state, you should learn to answer questions. And if you do those, God willing, and if any trust can be put in my own prophetic power, we shall both be the better for it. So it's like a Delphic oracle, a philosophical Delphic oracle. God willing, put any trust in my own prophetic power, too. Now Spidey's come back and recognized him and says, okay, as far as the points of my answering, we'll be doing all right. Come then. What is it to take care of oneself? In order that we may not be mistaken, as we often are. How do you know then? There's a whole thing we have to explore. What you are, right? Things of yours, things possessed, and that third category, what should we call it? Things that service the things that you possess? Right, that's the way I look at it. things or servicing the things you possess. Or maintaining.
Those things. Hey, you know, we have to do that. We have to make sure about these things. And therefore, in order to make these distinctions, we need the idea of art. Is that the way it goes? The way you see it? Right, because implicit in all that is the key word better, 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 better. And that's the key word that tells us an artist's function. You can find it all over there, do you know? Do you not say that a man takes proper care when he makes a thing better? And art then makes things better? And he has to. He reduces himself then on page 86 to the two arts, the one art by which each one of us takes care of himself, and the different one for the care of which is his. Right, so then out of this comes two arts, right, which is the art for himself, that takes care of himself, of self, and clearly, what is his. I'm doing this just for one purpose. And when you're taking care of that which is yours, you're not obviously taking care of yourself, you're engaging in a different kind of art. So he goes to the top of 87. Then he can, after making that distinction, he can then proceed with this side, can't he? Is that the way you say it? Come then, by what kind of art might we be able to take care of ourselves? State of mind. State of mind. I am unable to say. State of mind. At any rate, this much is agreed, that it is not the art by which we make better anything, whatever, that which is ours, but that by which we make ourselves better. True. Well, in order to know the art that makes ourselves better, what do you have to do? You have to know what the self is and what art it is. Right? It has to presuppose that you know in some way. Self. To make it better. Right? So it's, you better know the self if you're going to make it better. So if you intend to better the self, you have to know what you're bettering first. So if you intend to better the self, his advice is, hey, better know the self first.
And you have to know the self of souls. That's right.
Pardon?
And he says, step the self of souls.
I didn't.
He says, then you have to know, you have to discover the self of souls.
Yes, that curious phrase. Right?
Well, I think it's, well, my first impression was, I got spaced out. The second time I thought, well, if you knew what a shoe was, you'd know what your own shoe was. So if you knew what the self of souls is, you'd know what your own self was.
Yeah, I certainly think that we can put that over here. Talk about collect all of the self of souls. And so, hey, what do you think about this? Does it happen then to be an easy thing to know oneself? To me, Socrates, it is often seen to be a thing that anyone might attain, and to very difficult, another state of mind.
says it has often seemed the thing that anyone might attain, and often.
And often.
It's difficult.
Right.
But anyone can attain it.
See. Right, that's a statement.
Well, that's a strange... You're saying Alcibiades' state of mind right there.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I'm collecting. So.
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
I'm very interested in those responses.
Yeah.
It says, to me, it has often seemed the thing that anyone might attain. It's a very strange thing for him to say. He doesn't know.
Then he now is going to, at this point, now he's going to play with this relationship. Because up to this point, it was thought that you can do one side even though you don't know the other side. You should be able to take care of or engage in arts which are directed towards bettering that which is yours or your possessions or in the service and maintenance of the things that are in your possession. Okay, so that's an 88. Right. But whether it's easy or not, Alcibiades, the state of the case so far as your concern is this. If we knew ourselves, we might know how to take care of ourselves, but never otherwise. Yeah. But if we knew ourselves, we might know how to take care of ourselves. Well, how? You can't. This is the same dimension as this one, isn't it? All right. So if you know yourself, then you know how to take care of yourself. Take care of yourself. Just wanted to collect that. Sure. Well, then, hey, come on. In what manner might the self be discovered? Come then, what manner might the self be discovered? For thus, we could perhaps discover what we ourselves are. As long as we're ignorant of it, that'd be impossible.
Okay. Then there's a break there, isn't it? Right. There's a break. He's got that as the goal. He has this. Hey, how can you discover that? Now there's a break. Appears to be a, right, and remember we were talking about before in units? That appears to be a total break.
You mean Alcibiades' answer, or?
Socrates' answer. Listen then, the love of Zeus, with whom are you now conversing? Is it not with me? Well, how does that relate to anything? It is, am I conversing with you? You are. Is Socrates then who's discoursing? Yeah. And Socrates, Alcibiades listening? Yeah. Is not Socrates discoursing the means of speech? How else? And would you not call discoursing using speech the same thing?
Of course.
Yeah. Doesn't seem to have anything to do with what preceded. Like a complete shift. Right? We're on this. How do you discover this? Now we're talking about something so simple. He gives us the first clue that we're back on the same track. But the user and the thing used are different.
Mm-hmm.
What do you mean? It's about to help, you know? So, there's this linkage here. These are all simple little assertions, aren't they? Up to this point. The only thing that throws them now is the user and the thing used are different.
Well, that's the clue he's going to give to himself. To this.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
He goes really slow in this way, every little point.
Right. Hey. What? What do you mean by that? What's going on? Oh, examples now. Whole bunch. Whole bunch. Right, so that at 90,
Does the user always seem to be different from that which it uses? And he gets the point. He does.
Where is that?
That's on 90, page 90. After all of these examples, then he gets the point. The point that he wasn't able to see before. This then was the question which I asked you just now. Does the user always seem to be different from that which it uses? So he goes back to this one. He says, oh yeah. So he picks him up. That was the exploration that brought him back to that point. And he says, hey, wait a minute. Now he shifts to the whole body because he now can say, we use the body. So now comes the exploration of the body as the use. And that starts at 90. And it keeps going back to that point. The user is different than that which he uses. And do not all craftsmen not only use their eye, their hands and their eyes, but their whole body? Yes, and different than the user. And the man and his body are different things. But therefore is the man. Right? State of mind. I am unable to say. Remember on page 88? What about this self-knowledge? Is it an easy thing to know oneself? Sometimes I think it's easier to attain, other times it's too difficult. What therefore is the man? I am unable to say. That is to say, he doesn't separate that. He doesn't separate body and mind or body and soul. I don't know what the man is. What is the man? Well, and the three things, remember? The three things? Page 93. Man is one of three things, and it goes from that to 93. The man is the body or the soul or a combination of the two. Dusts off the combination with that line, least likely of all, for one of the principles of the subject is no means whatsoever, whereby they may both rule jointly. They both rule, and one of them, I say that. One of them is the subject. How can they both be ruled?
Hey, this goes in any school, because I was surprised you said that. Yeah. Alcibiades.
You mean true?
No, let's see.
The very likely? But does the compound of the two rule?
Yeah.
The body? And is this the man with the compound of the two?
Very likely.
And he shifts from very likely.
Yeah, he says very likely, and
that one sentence.
From what's gone so far before, for, you know, Alcibiades is kind of like he's trying to be a yes man or something, because he's not following this.
Yeah, and at this point, though, he's willing to drop the idea. Good. So therefore, he ends by saying, now I know what man is. We must conclude then that man is no other thing than soul.
No, sir, you see.
Hey, do you want us to prove this more clearly?
No,
it seems to me that it's proved sufficiently. If reasonably, well, but not accurately proved, is enough for us. as he then does, now that you now have that question about man, remember man on this issue? That's now resolved, so now we can go back to the self of selves. That which was said just now, in some such matter as this. First of all, the self of selves would have to be investigated. But now, instead of that, we have investigated the nature of the individual self. Perhaps that will be enough. For we could not say anything if we truly ourselves in the self. Okay, watch now. Whenever he gets on self of selves, he gives Alcibiades an excellent chance to explore it, and he never does. Never does. Well, let's go back to 88. Come then, in what manner might the self of selves be discovered?
We go back to?
Yeah, 88. For thus we could perhaps discover what we ourselves are. But so long as we're ignorant of it, that would be impossible. Just be true.
It doesn't answer the question. He's already been instructed to the way to go is to answer questions.
All right, so now watch what he does at 94. And perhaps that will be enough. For we cannot say that anything is more truly ourselves than the soul. Now, is it possible? Let me get rid of the hypothesis here. Yeah? If we stay in that paragraph.
You're on 94?
Yeah. And perhaps that will be enough. For we could not say that anything was more truly ourselves than the soul. Look here. Is he saying, therefore, the self of selves is the soul?
Individual soul?
It is, right?
Do you have that in my head? Right in the middle of page 94?
This is... Mm-hmm. We have it.
Go ahead.
He's not saying that it's the soul.
I have to say some more.
Well, he says, first of all, that the self of selves would have to be investigated. But now, instead of that, we have investigated the nature of the individual self. Mm-hmm.
Keep going.
And perhaps that will be enough. For we could not say that anything was more truly ourselves than the soul.
Yeah. I agree with the idea of individual self. Now, the last sentence is the one I wanted to stay on.
Mm-hmm.
How does the Lobby do it?
For surely we cannot say that anything has any more absolute possession of ourselves than the soul.
So that doesn't have the same force. That doesn't have the same force.
This is used B and then uses have.
No. Well, let me just go two more steps and I can stop. Then may we not fairly conclude that you and I are conversing with one another, that means the word soul to soul. Then by this way, we're communicating directly with the real Alcibiades, and that is the soul. That is, it's, would you agree, it is through the Logos in dialogue, through question and answer, that one reaches the real, that one reaches reaches and encounters the real person, i.e. the
soul. It seems so to me. Then he who enjoys know thyself bids us become acquainted with the soul. Right. Is it through this? Okay. Yes, there's a lot of nice philosophical material going on here. But didn't he then? These are states of his mind, aren't they? That we've marked here.
Huh? Alcibiades.
Alcibiades. He's had to then, right? He had to reveal the state of his mind, didn't he? So through this process, what is he doing? He's disclosing the state of his mind. He's coming to know by the very process of questions and answer and dialogue. So therefore, on page 95, then he who enjoins know thyself bids us become acquainted with the soul. Is he becoming acquainted with his soul through words in this very process? Right, it's like the dynamic behind the dialogue is to hit that again and again and again. Now, for Socrates to do that, he's getting him to explore states of mind, isn't he? What art is that? That art? That's a kind of knowledge, that's an art. And does he not say, hey, remember way back at 83 where we started? There's a certain power. Answer questions. And if you do this, God willing, if any trust can be put in my own prophetic power, we shall both be the better for it. So he thinks that this process can be said to be an art. It has a prophetic power. And it brings about a betterment. Addressing itself directly to the individual, and therefore it can fit that great description of art in the Republic. That is, there is a power based upon the knowledge. On the basis of that, the practitioner has a right to have a power over his subjects as long as it's for their benefit. And the benefit must be that they become better and the better part of themselves. And that's what Socrates is saying to Alcibiades. Then therefore at the bottom of 95. Pardon?
It looks like he's playing the philosophical.
He's playing the philosophical. Right, then wisdom is the knowledge of oneself. Mm-hmm. And one is only wise owing to this craft. Therefore he's playing the philosophical Delphicorn. Know thyself through the exploration of questions, and you become acquainted with certain states of mind which are better for the principles. Now, they continue this little thing from 95, and I think you can just glance at it several lines. And then go to page 98, and that pulls it together with 83, and then we can do something else. This then was the reason that I alone loved you. But the others, that which is yours, this then was the reason that I alone loved you. But the others, that which is yours. That which is yours is losing its freshness, but you are beginning to bloom. And now, if you're not spoiled by the Athenian people and made less fair, I shall never desert you. For this is what I fear most, that you should become a lover of the people and be lost to us. And he bypasses the antidote.
It's wow. Interesting. You know, somebody doesn't say what's the antidote.
Yeah.
That's what I wanted to know.
Yeah, I really was looking for it.
Yeah, that's good. By Socrates?
Yeah.
Yes, guys.
Have you got the antidote there?
Did he get it?
To know myself.
It might be.
It says you may be prepared with an antidote. It's not a definite antidote.
Okay. Then how do you become better? How do you take care of yourselves by becoming better? And what things do you take care of the soul? Look to it. How do you do that? Well, we have to look to the analogy you did. Sight. Remember? And that's where we wanted to explore, did we not? The analogy of sight and soul. Steps are interesting, I guess. Okay, so he wants to just explain the manner in which we take care of ourselves. Well, you've got to take care of the soul. Look to it. When Sock gives him a challenge, it starts it. In what way, therefore, can we know the soul most clearly? Because you can't take care of it if you don't know it. And knowing this, it seems, we shall know ourselves also. I'll tell you what I suspect in counsel, which the Delphic Oracle inscription has for us. And I think you can find it in an illustration. Not everywhere, but only inside. What do you mean? Okay, so the analogy starts at the bottom of 99. And it goes through seven steps, and then the analogy comes in. The other part of the analogy comes in, and he drives it home to a conclusion. Want me to get it for
you? No, I'll get it. Thanks.
Let's take out the states of mind, we're out of that now. All right. He's going to expand the first relationship. When he has sufficient material developed, he then shifts to the second. But when he shifts to the second set of terms, he includes additional elements that belong over here to A and B. So it's a nice growing analogy. He increases both sides as he makes points. I think it's done very well. Do you not agree we should be able to find it in those sections that he develops? And then when we have it, then we go on this side, and then we should simply be able to take the key terms and put them in this side and see it on both sides. Same old way of applying analogies, isn't it?
What exactly are you looking at? What exactly is analogy?
Well, we haven't.
I mean, what is it you're looking at?
The site.
Site
of knowledge. Knowledge at the bottom of page 101.
All
right. 199, pardon. I thought you said, what was the analogy? Okay. The problem? All right. how to know ourselves most clearly.
Here?
Yeah.
Most clearly, you know that term for the shining pattern in the soul?
Oh, no.
That's the superlative of it.
Oh, no. I quit. I quit. God.
What's the reference?
That's the superlative, the one in the...
Oh, in the Republic?
No, in the low.
In the low. 132C. Six, maybe?
132D6?
Yeah, C6.
C6.
Last of the line, NR, see it? NR, yes, that dot?
132 or 133?
Okay.
Yeah, for the benefit of everyone, how would you ideally like to translate that word? Just so that everybody can have a little flavor of that lovely quote.
Brightly shining from within, most brightly shining from within. How'd you go with it? David, the big scholar, is here. Let him off, if he would offer.
Within?
Well, from, well, in, what do you do with the N? Go with whatever you see. I don't mind being corrected.
The most purely NR Gesvata, whatever that is. The most purely
self-luminous.
Yeah.
That's good.
Right. Better.
Well, better. Come on, do it again.
The most purely self-luminous.
Not too much on the purely, but the most self-luminous.
The most self-luminous.
Yeah. And
so how shall we obtain... Go ahead.
The most self-luminous knowledge?
Yeah, that's really... That's sad.
Well, it depends on whether it's intransitive or transitive. We can either know it or it is known, most purely. I think the way it goes is how might we know, in what way might we know it most, in what way might we know that thing in itself most purely?
What way might we know most purely the self-luminous nature of self?
Yeah, right. That's better. I like that.
Pure. What's the pure coming from?
I didn't. I just made it up.
That most purely in itself, that thing most purely in itself. In what way might we know that thing which is known most purely in itself?
really.
The most self-luminous. The object is not. The object is not. It's a
the way our gods most distinctly appear
in their own form
into the mind.
Yeah, I guess it has to do with the mind, distinct, and that the self is reflected most clearly in the logos. Therefore, or the logos is a mirror. Real Taoist, huh? Or Chinese kind of thing. Before you can make the state better, you gotta figure out how to make yourself better.
Start
yeah, it's a great learning, isn't it? This is the great learning.
Being in action.
Yeah, great learning.
See, what's nice about that I mean, if that's the way it could be read most simply by someone who knew the language, then you could say that when Plato's audience, that was accepted without discussion. That the self, or the soul, would be self-luminous. I mean, that's a nice cultural view.
Yeah, it's even got the most brilliant aspect to it.
Then if they talked about the idea of good as being brilliant, the most brilliant of all luminous forms, you'd say, oh, yeah. It fits in the same tradition.
The whole idea, too, of being able to see it clearly, right, reflection in something. You want something that will reflect what's what in something most clearly, as a standard, you know.
And if it's luminous, then it would make sense that you could see it in something reflected.
Yeah, I guess so. Luminous things are reflectable things.
Yeah, reflectable
things. Some strange proposition of light.
Yeah.
Wow.
Just to quickly look at this, we do not agree. The following seven paragraphs, the bottom of 99.1, that continues to page 100. Each succeeding Socrates statement is making a further step in the development of the image that was on the left, the known side, which has to deal with sight. Starting with, the eye should look at that by looking at which it would see itself. First, ending the seventh point on top of the line. Then the eye is to see itself. Right? If the eye could see itself, it must look at an eye. And at that part of the eye, I resides. This is, I suppose, sight. Then he moves into the other part, part of the analogy, the next paragraph. The soul, too, if she were to know herself, so that's where he applies it, doesn't he? So I take that to be one. On the other side. And sequentially from that, the same point as we made a moment ago, that is, that he is developing further that image. All right, 2, 3, 4. To the page 1 or 2 and the consequences of that analogy proceed from 102 on. Which allows him to make that beautiful three-part division that Rod mentioned on 103.
Why don't you work that out?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I just want to just go a couple of minutes. Then on 106, Variety pushes that a little bit. When we started on page 82, he uses a certain language about God willing, you see it on 83. And therefore, it's important, what does he mean by the will of God? So that 106, he goes back to that issue about the will of God and fulfills it in. And at 106, these exchanges, I would love to see, for any hidden images, obviously, to the light, the splendid light. Right, Bob? And Sarah and David?
You know, like you said before, you like that's kind of good.
Yeah, if you want to look for a mistranslation, it's going to be on 106.
Why don't you read to the content so we can pick it up in a little?
I'm on 134D.
134D? I don't have both.
For both you and the city, if you act justly and wisely, will act in accordance with the will of God.
That quote right there is 134.
Okay, great.
Good.
Thank you.
And as we said before,
yeah.
You will act thus by looking at that which is divine and splendid. Mm-hmm. I would say that smells.
Yeah, it's bright in here, and it's lampos.
Yeah, right.
Well, yeah, like lamppost.
Yeah, right.
That's good.
What, you guys?
Lamppost.
Lamppost.
Lamponet. It's lamppost.
What lobby is that?
135D4.
134D4.
Lampoon? Don't tell me. Lampooning will do.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's taking a drink, but from the French. But. It's like a lamp.
Hey, hello, this is...
Getting on it.
Yeah, design is right.
What god, is this Apollo? Is this Apollo? You can't say what the god is, you can't say what the art is, what the goddesses we are. Earlier he asked me that question. What's he doing for eyes turned there? Is that the... Eyes turned there. I was looking at what was the guy was trying to figure out what the guy was doing. Keeping your eyes turned, right? What does it say in that text? Looking at on the divine and the bright and the luminous. Bright shining kind of all. Yeah. Is it apples left on fixed that kind of what it was? Or wrong? So anyway. It's still that same kind of model, isn't it? Mm-hmm. But it's fixed, firmly fixed.
Looking there on, but you got Lepontes.
Next section down. God, that's great. And the other model, the godless and the dark, right? Contrast with the other model, godless and dark. Three. Down the bottom, it's 1, 2, 4, 3, 4.
Come to that.
we need to share, or you got something delicious over there?
I text, I'm just looking at this. Look at the virtue of the soul, that's its wisdom. Any part of the soul more divine, and that which is the seat of knowledge and thought, Adonai and Pronon. And if that part resembles God, who looks on that comes to know all that's divine. The all of us, you know, it's from that. It's a nice encompassing model.
Yeah, you didn't need much of that.
No.
Well, okay.
Let's just build one side and then up to two. What should we do? Get easier. What do you have to do first when you're doing an analogy?
The easier, the known.
Right.
Why don't we get a reader to just go through that 100, 101?
Then we can just put it into the model. Would it not be that the eye should look, right? It's a should. The eye should look at that. Key term for our analogy.
Were you at
100? Would it not be that the eye should look at that by looking at which it would see itself? Second point, let us consider then what that object is in looking at which we see ourselves at same time. Right? Second point to me. Analogy. Is there not something of this kind in the eye by which we see? In the eye by which we see. In the eyes of the person opposite him, right? Who looks in the eye of another, right? He looks in the eye of another. Have you noticed that the face of anyone who looks in the eye of another is visible as in a mirror? Right? The model he's using in the eye of another. And since he's in the game of question and answer dialogue, right? It's not just looking in a mirror as in a mirror, but not the mirror. It's in another. In the eyes of the person opposite him. And so we call this the pupil peak. Why? Because it is an image, right, of the beholder. So an eye, beholding an eye, looking at its most, right? Looking at its most perfect part. And that by which it sees itself. Six. But if it looks any other part of the man, or at any other object, except that which itself resembles, must look at that which it resembles. Must look at that which or sees nothing. We don't need that last part that I just threw in. Seven, and if the eye is to see itself, it must look at an eye, and at that part of the eye in which the virtue of the eye virtue of the eye resides. And it completes it. Sight. That's the, for him, that's the key element of the sight. And we're going to look for all of those things that we have seven. Now, when he goes on this side, he's going to pick up these terms.
He's going to pick that one right there.
All right. He's going to pick these terms, and you can see what he's doing. All right? Agreed? As numbers, let's just use numbers, all right? Now, on the other two terms over here, on this side, all right, this is the sight, this is the soul. All right, you read off the numbers, we just play with numbers. And so, my dear Alcibiades, the soul, too, if she is to know herself, must look at soul, especially at that region of soul in which wisdom, the virtue of the soul, resides, and at whatever else is like this.
Seven.
What else? How about six? That which resembles. Is that there? And whatever else is like this. Well, in the quote on page 101.
It looks like it goes directly to seven.
Yeah, I agree. And seven. And whatever else is like this. Would that be that which it resembles?
Well, and it says soul.
Yeah. Yeah. So the first point on the side of the soul.
Or the region of the soul. That's right.
Yeah.
Looking at the soul is resolved.
Okay. The second point. Right. The second point for the soul. And can we say that any region of the soul is more divine than that which is the seat of knowledge and understanding?
It's purifying an idea of what sight would be in the eye. Mm-hmm. Seven. Sounds like he's going further here.
Five.
Oh, I see.
We're looking for something, all right, more divine
When we say that any region of the soul is more divine than that which to receive knowledge and understanding. So it's the best part of the eye, right, which you call the pupil.
Mm-hmm.
And also, looking at its most perfect part. Agree? Looking at the most perfect part? So what's he doing? Can anyone hazard a guess? All right. His third point. All right. This region of the soul then is most like to God.
But he's working.
What?
Is he working backwards?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And one who looked at this came to all that is divine, God and all wisdom of this gained most knowledge and so on.
I don't see that in those reading steps.
Well, how is four? What's four? Just picture it in terms of this model only. You remember four? Then have you noticed that the face of anyone who looks in the eye of another is visible, as in a mirror, in the eyes of the person opposite. So we call this the pupil, because it is the image of the beholder.
Face of the divine.
Four. Shall we not say then that just as mirrors are clear and pure and bright on the mirror, and I have God is clear and bright for us in our soul. Now, this is extended, so we can have some fun about it. Right, we can just add fun to that. Gives me a chance. Brighter turns out to be more luminous. This translator will quickly be sent a rose. Four-part analogy there, does we? Okay, for the conclusion, I'm 1 of 2. Looking at God, therefore, we should use His most beautiful mirror, right, which isn't in here, all right? Because now he's making a metaphor, God's mirror. Right, so we'll raise the ante of this one step. Huh?
I just told him it wasn't his foot.
Oh, yeah. We'll give his mirror a better frame, more expensive frame.
looking at God, therefore, we should use this most beautiful mirror, and among human affairs, we should look at the virtue of the soul, and this we may best see and know ourselves. Looking at God, therefore, we use this most beautiful mirror, and among human affairs, we should look at the virtue of the soul, and thus we may best see and know ourselves. Right? So, how does Loeb do that one?
Dope.
Anyone have a Jawa? It'd be interesting to get someone else's.
Oh, that would be interesting. Do you have numbers?
Which part would you like?
That's just on the whole section.
Consider, if someone were to say to the eye, see thyself, as you might say to a man, know thyself, what is the nature and meaning of this precept? Would not his meaning be that the eye should look at that in which it would see itself clearly? And what is the object in looking at which we see ourselves? Clearly, Socrates, in looking at mirrors and the like. Very true, and is there not something of the nature of a mirror in our own eyes? Certainly. Did you ever observe that the face of the person looking into the eye of another is reflected in the visual organ, which is over against him, and which is called the pupil, as in a mirror? There is a sort of image of the person looking. That is quite true. Then the eye looking at another eye, and at that in which, and at that in the eye which is most perfect, and which is the instrument of vision, will there see itself? That is evident. But looking at anything else in man or in existence, and not to that which is light, it will not see itself. That is true. Then if the eye is to see itself, it must look at the eye, and at that part of the eye in which the virtue of the eye resides. And this, I suppose, sight? True. And if the soul, my dear Alcibiades, is ever to know herself, must she not look at the soul, and especially at that part of the soul in which her virtue resides, which is like herself? I agree, Socrates. And do we know of any part of our souls more divine than that which has to do with wisdom and knowledge? There is none. Then this is the part of the soul which resembles the divine. And he who looks at this and knows all that is divine will be most likely to know himself. That is plain. The self-knowledge we acknowledge to be wisdom. True. And if we have no self-knowledge and no wisdom, can we ever know our own good and evil? How is that possible? You mean that if you did not know Alcibiades, there would be no possibility of your knowing what belonged to Alcibiades? Was really his? The possibility of your knowing that what belonged to Alcibiades was really his.
He doesn't have it either.
Yeah, he doesn't have it either. Okay. Back in that one that I wanted to, all right? Looking at God, therefore, we should use his most beautiful mirror, and among human affairs, we should look at the virtue of the soul. And thus we may best see and know ourselves. What's the virtue of the soul?
That's wisdom. Right? We picked that up from the previous two sections, right? So looking at God, therefore, we produce His most beautiful mirror. See, that's very strained, doesn't it, as a sentence. Looking at God, therefore, produces the most beautiful mirror. And among human affairs, we should look at the virtue of the soul, which is most like the mirror of God. And thus we may best see and know ourselves. That's the way it should be. Right? But that's very difficult the way it is in English. Right, because therefore we should say, right, what is this doing? God's mirror. It's not doing anything in a sentence. It's a poor sentence, so it seems to.
Which part? You mean his most beautiful mirror, or?
Well, there's one thing has nothing to do with the other.
Grace is at a higher level.
There's a double. There's an analogy. I think God should look at his most beautiful mirror, or whatever that means. The highest among the divine.
Yeah.
And among human affairs, we should look at the highest among human soul, I guess, which would be the virtue of the soul, which is wisdom.
That's true. That's what it says.
I don't understand the first part of the sentence.
Huh?
Is that what you're saying?
No, I'm saying that it could be made clearer.
Oh, yeah. That's not even a parallel structure.
That's what I'm saying. It's not a parallel structure. So that's what I suggest, something like that in there.
When we look at God, therefore, we should use His most beautiful mirror, and looking at human affairs, we should look at the. We should use the most beautiful part of the soul.
Right. Some parallel.
Yes. Yeah.
It's not connected. It's two things that are not related to two things.
Yeah, clearly.
Yeah.
And we all have good texts.
I have one.
Yeah.
And we agree that to know oneself is wisdom. Right? So that's this. Right? It's coming back. Therefore, to know oneself, this then becomes wisdom. And what would be nice if we had the mean term connecting wisdom and the mirror of God, then that would be a very splendid way to tie it all up together. Because then we could say, that's what we should look at. At the same time, you see that, you see yourself, it's instantaneous. Right? And that is in the soul, and it is that by which we know, which is wisdom. Right? So that way you get 1, 2, and 3. Makes it pleasant.
That's very interesting, because earlier we said you see the eye, but looking at the eye sees itself, but looking at the part of the eye, it looks like itself. Just looking at the pupil range. And then it says to see, really you see the sight, right? Here we say looking at God, we don't want to just look at God's pupil. We want to look at something as clear than just looking at the eye. We look at the mirror. And I think the mirror is like sight. When we're looking at the eye, we see the eye. The better way to look at the eye is to look in a mirror. And here we look at God's most beautiful mirror, which means look at God's vision. That sort of divine vision. And that could be much better than that.
Well, anyhow, it was fun. This point on its slides home.
What would cause two translators to leave out such an important
Maybe these are different texts too, use the same, obviously use the same text as this.
And yeah, he turns.
Really skip those, you can see it followed it.
Yeah,
But Rod's got the the word, what's the opera called? That's the standard text. There are several versions.
You know, if someone was translating a Hindu text or a Tibetan text, translator left out terms like luminous and self-luminous, and all of these key words, which have a very vital role in the whole history of philosophical mysticism, they'd be laughed at. But they can sure do it for the Greek world. Oh. Hey, what are we going to do next time?
This only has the answer.